Welcome this morning to the Grants Pass Seventh-day Adventist Church. We're so glad that you've chosen to join us this morning for our worship service. Special Sabbath here. Every Sabbath is a special day in which we can worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'd like to welcome not only those who are here present in the sanctuary, but those who have chosen to join us by the live stream as well. It's great to have you with us today. I have several announcements here. Many of them are in your bulletin, and I encourage you to check your bulletin because there are many things that won't be mentioned during these announcements, but they're in the bulletin. So please be sure to read your bulletin as well. I'd like to call attention to the fact that Monday is New Year's Day. We begin 2024, and being a holiday, that means that our church office will be closed this Monday. Also, just to remind you that given that tomorrow is the last day of 2023, that also means that tomorrow is the last day to give in terms of tithes, offerings, that sort of thing, if you want it credited to the 2023 tax year. Anything that is received in the church office after tomorrow or postmarked after tomorrow will be credited as a contribution made in 2024. So just keep that in mind. Also, the Garden Club has been meeting once per month. I believe it's been a different day during 2023 than it will be going forward in 2024. So starting this coming Tuesday, January 4th, the Garden Club will be meeting 6:30 p.m. in the BLC, and that'll be the first Tuesday of every month. So, and I understand that the Garden Club is enjoying getting together and encourage you to be a part of that. Also, next Sabbath, so a week from today, will be a communion service. So just take note of that, next Sabbath, communion. I believe that's all the announcements that I wanted to share this morning, but I know Heidi has an announcement for us as well. And immediately following Heidi's announcement, we'll begin the church service in song.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. I'm just listening to all those announcements, and we're definitely at the end and at the beginning at the same time. It's a very interesting time of year. It's been over a year and a half, at 6:30 in the morning, there's been a group of us meeting to pray every day. We have some time for reading, and then we have time to pray. We're praying for you. We're praying for our leaders. We're praying for our children. We're praying for the world. There's some chaos going on in our world, as many of you know. And this next, starting on Monday, we'll be starting a new devotional book. And it's called The Upward Look by Ellen White. And we have been so blessed, so challenged by the readings that we've had in this current book that we've been reading through called Ye Shall Receive Power. And we have just had a very beautiful time meeting together, drawing close as a family. If you're looking for a small group to join, I encourage you. There's an insert in your bulletin that will tell you how to get connected with the prayer call. However, I will say this one thing. It meets at 6:30 in the morning, and in talking with some of you, that's kind of a problem. Not all of us are up at 6:30 in the morning, and I can attest that there are days that 6:30 doesn't happen for me either. So if anybody is wanting and interested in a prayer call, but would like a different time of day, please come and talk to me, and we'll see what we can do. All right. Look forward to seeing as many of you as we can on our prayer call. Thank you.
Good morning, church family. It's good to see you on this wonderful Sabbath morning. Our theme this morning was heaven and homeland. So we're going to start out with when we all get to heaven. Aren't we looking forward to that? It is 6:33 in your hymnal if you don't have it memorized. Getting ready for heaven, we need to give the best to the Master. The song is on page 572. This might be one that you've not heard before. I don't think we sing it very often, but it has beautiful words. We'll be singing the first and last stanza of it.
Give up the strength of your youth.
next song we're going to sing is called Now the Joyful Bells Are Ringing. And you think, I don't know that song. Well, the words are a little different, but the tune you will recognize. It's on page 23. For our opening song, we'll be singing 439, which is How Far From Home. Would you please stand with us as we sing?
Morning. Heavenly Father, Lord, we are safe when we are in your hands, in your arms. Lord, as we come to the end of another year, Lord, we know that we are approaching that soon return of Jesus. Lord, please be with us in this worship service. May your angels be here to just impress upon us that which you would have us to understand, that we would be blessed, that we'd be drawn closer to you, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So at this time, we have the time for our little ones to come forward and grab their nets so that we can collect for an offering that goes to our Worthy Student Fund for those that are desiring to go to our church school and learn of Jesus as well as academics, but maybe are a little short financially to be able to do that. So this is able to help them to be able to get a Christian education. So children, come forward at this time and collect that offering.
Good. I'm glad you're doing well. How are you? Oh, not too sure. How are you?
Good.
Good, 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 good. You know, when I was a little boy, I had a little sister. Do any of you have a little sister? Yeah, okay. Some of you have a little sister. Do you like your little sisters?
Yeah.
Yeah, little sisters are great, aren't they? Well, I was good friends with my little sister. You wish you had a sister? Maybe you'd better talk to mom and dad. So when I was a little boy, my sister and I were good friends. And my sister believed everything I told her. Oh, she did things with me, and we had lots of fun, and she believed me. So one day we were outside, and we were walking around, and guess what we saw? We saw some flowers. It might have been like this, or it might have been a daisy, like you see on the screen right here. And I told her, you know what? Those petals on those flowers, we can take them off of the flower like this, and you can pull them off, and you can pull them off, and you can pull them off. And then I said, you know what? We can put them back on. Yes, we can. Well, what do you need to put those petals back on that flower? You need some glue. So I went and I got some glue from the house, and I took the petals that we had taken off, and I put it on the flower, and I glued it back on the flower. And I told my sister, those petals are going to live. This will work just fine. Yeah. Would you have believed me?
No.
No, you wouldn't? How about you? Would you have believed me? Not too sure. Not too sure, huh? Well, can you glue petals back on the flower? You might be able to. Will they live?
No.
No, they're not going to live. And my sister kind of knew better, but she kind of trusted me, and she kind of didn't know better. Guess what? Gluing petals onto a flower might be kind of like saying you believe in Jesus, but not trusting Jesus. You know, the Bible talks about being connected to the vine. Have you heard of that story? Unless you're connected to the vine, you won't live. Just like unless that petal is connected to the flower and the stem, you won't live. The same is true of us. If we're not connected to Jesus, we won't spiritually live. We won't live the truth in Jesus. So now I have a really, really hard question for you. We can't see Jesus, and we don't have any glue to glue ourselves to Jesus like we tried to glue those petals to that flower. So how do you stay connected to Jesus?
By praying.
Praying is what? Talking to Jesus?
Putting Jesus in your heart.
And how do you do that? And yes, you had a question.
Reading the Bible.
That's good. What did you say? By obeying, that's all good. That's very good. I'm going to suggest
by having worship with him.
By having worship with him. Key, you're doing good. You're doing good. But what is actually not gluing, but actually being real, for real connected? I'm going to suggest to you that we connect ourselves to Jesus by trusting him. What do you think of that? Maybe so? That's how you connect yourself to Jesus, is you trust in Jesus. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you that we can connect to you. Teach us to trust you. We do trust you. And go with us through this week and new year. Amen.
Amen.
You can go back to your seats now. Thank you for coming for the story.
Now is that most special time during our worship service in which we can worship God through our giving. And today's offering is for the Alaska Conference. This offering is specifically designated to a special fund called Arctic Mission Adventure. And it's used in remote regions of Alaska to reach people for Christ. Now, this isn't our usual offering, so I'm going to share a little story that I think will illustrate how this offering can be used. This story is about a work that's happening in just one small place in Alaska's vast remote lands. This story begins many years ago. Nathan Nauk was born in 1910 in the village of Savunga, on St. Lawrence Island, just 35 miles from Russia. He was a leader in his village, and he delivered mail to Nome, Savunga, and Gamble using dog sled teams. In the mid-1950s, tuberculosis was rampant in Alaska Native communities. Nathan contracted the disease. Despite feeling weak and coughing up blood, he took his dog team 240 miles across the Bering Sea to Nome to seek treatment. From Nome, Nathan was flown to a sanitarium in Tacoma, Washington. During this lonely time, his only comfort was a small Sony transistor radio. Soon he discovered the Voice of Prophecy program by HMS Richards, Sr. And as he slowly recovered, Nathan listened to this program every day for a year and a half. In 1957, Nathan gave his heart to Jesus. He was baptized and became the very first Alaska Native Seventh-day Adventist on St. Lawrence Island. When he returned to Savunga, he shared his new faith, but it was not accepted. But even when people shunned him, Nathan held firm to his faith. His wife, Jeanette, watched him live his faith for 3 years before she, too, accepted Jesus and was baptized. Slowly, two small groups of Native Adventists formed, one in Savunga and one in Gamble. The Savunga Church has now grown to 46 members, with another 16 non-members regularly attending Sabbath services. In Gamble, there are now 59 members and 49 non-members regularly attending. Nathan's influence is still felt in Savunga. In fact, in July of this year, Elder Kevin Miller, president of the Alaska Conference, baptized Nathan's grandson and his two great-grandsons, plus 8 other people. Before baptism, these individuals studied the Bible with Eloise Hawks, an Arctic mission adventure worker, for several years. These baptisms were made possible by the financial support of donors just like you and me. Today's offering is designated to the Arctic Mission Adventure Fund so that more souls in the remote regions of Alaska can be reached for Christ. And I'd just like to point out that a $25,000 matching pledge has been put forward, which means that your offering today will be matched dollar for dollar to reach Native Americans in Alaska. So please consider giving generously. Now, if you'd like to give to any other purpose, because this is our loose offering today, but if you want to give to any other purpose, be sure and fill out the tithe and offering envelope in front of you to clearly designate what you're giving for. At this time, would the deacons please stand and we will pray. Our loving Father in heaven, we thank you so much that we have the privilege and the opportunity to give this morning for reaching peoples in remote regions of Alaska, reaching them with a saving message of Jesus Christ and his love for all of humanity. We thank you so much. We pray that these monies would be multiplied in ways that we cannot begin to understand, miraculous ways to reach people in remote areas. And we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Good morning and happy Sabbath. Last Sabbath, I was at Colorado and had a white Christmas. And I want to send greetings from Sandra Chin. We had a nice visit while I was back there. We had a change in our special scripture today. We have a different pastor. So I want to, it's going to be John 13, 34, and 35. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another.
Good morning as well. Is it on? Okay. I want to announce that if we could keep the Hallmark family in prayer. Roger passed away yesterday. And also, if you could send a card or a text or a phone call to the family, I know they would really appreciate it. And also, Ron Matheson has hurt his back, and he's on the way to ER, or is in ER right now. And so if you could keep him and his wife in prayer as well. There's lots of people to pray for on our prayer list. And I know it means a lot if you send a text or if you send a phone call or make a phone call or send just a little get well card. I know there's several ladies in our congregation that do send out get well cards. And I know they're very appreciated. If you would like to kneel with me for prayer, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we've had 52 weeks here in 2023 that we could come together and celebrate your Sabbath. And we look forward to the 52 weeks coming up, Father, for 2024. You tell us in Deuteronomy, Father, that what you would love for us to do is to love you with all of our hearts, with all of our soul, and with all of our strength. And Father, as I relate that to the memory verse that was just, or the verse that was just read, if we love you with all of our hearts and with all of our strength, and with our whole soul, we will love others. And Father, I just pray that this year, we will reach out to those who are hard to reach. Reach out and just touch them with the love that you can only give us, Father. Let us see your children through your eyes. And that's all the children, Father, from birth on up to 95, 99, whatever. Lord, teach us to be kind. Teach us to be loving. Teach us to be giving. Teach us to be more like you. That's our prayer for 2024, Father. Help us, guide us, and let us always know, Father, let us always tell you how much we love you and that we want to be your children. We are desirous to do your will, Father. May we rest in your peace, and as the children's story said, may we trust in you with all of our hearts. I pray all of this, Father, in Jesus' name, amen.
Jordan River. lasting joy and peace. Where the stream of life is flowing there forever, and a crown of life is waiting there for me. That sounds like home to me, right where I want to be. There'll be no tears to fill our eyes again. The hills will echo with the story as we sing of His grace and glory, where the saints of God will be. That sounds like home to me. Oh, they say there's only joy inside that city, and little children playing by the stream of life. Disappointments there can hurt us. And Jesus Christ Himself will be the light. That sounds like home to me, right where I long to be. There'll be no tears to fill our eyes again. The hills will echo with the story as we sing of His grace and glory, where the saints of God will be. That sounds like home to me. That sounds like home to me, right where I want to be. There'll be no tears to fill our eyes again. And glory, where the saints of God will be. That sounds like home to me.
Thank you, Tammy. Yes, that definitely sounds like home. You know, in Hebrews chapter 11, we're told that we are strangers and pilgrims in this land, aren't we? We are not to be putting down stakes. This is not our home. This is not our home. Well, for those of you that have observed in your bulletin and then looking up here that the same person in the bulletin is not the person up here, I commend you for your astuteness. Because Pastor Nelson let me know Thursday and then confirmed it Friday that he would not going to be able to make it to the pulpit because of sickness, so he asked me to fill in. So I had a message that had been running around in my mind my head for about 2 months. I just hadn't put it on paper, so that definitely prompted me to put it on paper. And so I asked the Lord, Lord, make sure that the message I put together is your message, not my message. And so I want to pray for that. Those of you that know me, I want to be praying that, Lord, this is what you would have me to share, because I've entitled it the most important message. At least in my opinion, it's the most important message. And other people may have in their hearts what the most important message is, and we all may have something different, but for us, it's what is the most important message that's going to connect us to Jesus. So if you could you pray with me before we begin? Father in heaven, Lord, we want to thank you again for another Sabbath, another opportunity to come to you and to worship you, to learn of you. And Lord, I pray that as I speak this morning, that you would take just the reins and you would speak through me, Lord, that I would be your mouthpiece, that the message that is shared, each one of us would take from it, Lord, what you want us to understand, that our hearts would be drawn closer to you. We pray that your angels would be here that excel in strength, keep back any evil forces that would want to disrupt or confuse in any way, but Lord, that would come home to each of our hearts and minds that which you want us to know. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And as I was mentioned putting together this message, you know, this message, I was thinking, this is for me, you know. And so when I'm sharing this, just know this is for me as much as it is for you. You know, it's interesting because when you prepare a message, like myself, Pastor Nelson, whoever, what do you present? Because there's in the congregation and a viewing audience, that there's a lot of people that are hurting. There are people that are discouraged. There are people that are maybe doubting God. They're questioning God because, you know, something that's happened in their life has caused them to question if God really loves them, if God really is there. There's people that want to hear about current events and how that relates to us today. You know, we see the signs fulfilling all around us. There's people that want to know, how can Scripture be relevant to me? It was written 2,000 years ago, minimum, and even longer than that. How can that be relevant to me? Some people want to know that. Some people want to know, how do I live the victorious Christian life? So, you know, what do you speak on? Because these are all important topics, are they not? And to some, each individual, one of these topics may be more important to them than it is than another one is. And we know that God wants to comfort the hurting, doesn't he? He wants to lift the discouraged out of the pit of despair. He wants to give those that are doubting, those that are questioning if God really cares about me, he wants to give them the assurance of his amazing love for them, that he truly does care for their best interest. Even if they don't understand at this moment why certain things are happening in their life the way they are. He wants us to know that the Word of God has relevancy in our lives, even though it was written 2,000 years ago and even beyond. And he wants us to know what is happening in the world now and how it relates to end time events. He doesn't want us to get blindsided. That's why he tells us in Amos 3 that he will do nothing unless he reveals it to his servants, the prophets, first. So we know that God wants us to understand how these things that are happening in the world, that they relate. I mean, and if you've got your pulse on what's happening in the world, you know, maybe know about things like Project 2025, global climate change crisis, AI, how AI is just exploding, the potential of a global cyber attack. Gender confusion, all these things are telling us that Jesus is coming soon. So with all that said, why do we follow Jesus? Why follow Jesus? Well, before people are willing to love Christ and follow him, they need to understand his character, right? That makes sense? They need to understand why he is worthy of their love. Why he is worthy of their obedience to his teachings. I mean, we see that in human relationships, don't we? When that young man meets that young woman, you know, they don't just naturally give their hearts out right away to that person, do they? They want to know that their person can be trusted with that heart they're going to give to him. That it's safe, they're not going to step on it. They're not going to abuse it, you know. So they need to take time to understand their character. What is their character like? Is it safe for me to give my heart to this person, to trust this person? So there are many people who really don't understand the character of Christ. And we may think, well, of course, you know, there's so many people out there in the world, especially in third world countries, that never even heard of Jesus. But there are people that don't understand the character of Christ right here in our country. You know, there are people that don't understand the character of Christ, even in the Seventh-day Adventist church. Maybe those that are in this country, who you'd think was a Christian country in a sense, maybe there are people, they've never been in a position to learn about God because he wasn't talked about in their home, you know. Their parents didn't bring him up, didn't talk about God because maybe they themselves didn't learn about God in their home, or maybe they had a bad experience about God in their home, and for that reason they said, you know, we're not going to have God in our home because we had just a bad experience with him. So whatever reason, the children have learned with had no interest in God because they didn't learn about God. Or maybe they've grown up, if we're talking about those within the church, maybe they have grown up in an environment where God was talked about. Maybe they went to church on a regular basis. But as they grew up, it left them with more questions than it did answers. Maybe it's because of the way God was presented in the home. Or maybe in their school, their church school was teaching, or maybe through their friends or whatever. Maybe the way God was portrayed to them, it left them with more questions than it did answers. Even though the parents may have done their best to share who God was and what God was all about. Even though they had a training from their parents, the parents did what was best. But maybe the way they were taught from their parents, that they had maybe got some skewed ideas of who God was and what the character of Jesus is all about. Well, whatever the reason that people don't know Jesus, believe me, he longs for us to know him. He longs for us to know and to know the great love that he has for us. Amen. But we also know that even though Jesus has this great desire for us to know him and to be in relationship with him, not only here but for all eternity, we know that we're in a great controversy. There is an adversary that is doing all he can to create doubt in our hearts about God's character of love. All you have to do is to go back to the Garden of Eden, right? And just look at Adam and Eve. Here are two beings, unfallen in nature. I mean, we have a fallen nature. We have a bent towards selfishness. But here is two beings that were unfallen in nature. And yet Eve was deceived by the evil one. Deceived about the character of God. You know, God doesn't want you to eat that tree because if you do, you're going to be like him. A wrong representation of who God was. And sadly to say, even in her unfallen nature, Eve fell for the deception, which should be a warning for us in our nature, how easy it is for Satan to deceive us unless we are protected by the Word of God and by Jesus. So there are some things that we're just not going to get answers to on this side of heaven, are we? Some things that for whatever reason God chooses not to tell us. You know, Deuteronomy 29:29, the secret things belong unto God, but those things that are revealed belong unto us and to our children. And it's not because God is being secretive or indifferent, even though he says these are secret things. It's because God knows that we don't see the complete picture. We don't have the completeness of understanding what's happening in this great controversy. We may have a good idea, but we may not have the completeness of understanding. But one day, on the other side, we'll understand why some of those things that perplex us, some of those things that confuse us, we'll understand why they happen, and we're going to see the harmony of why God allowed those things to happen the way they did. Okay? I mean, think about this. I'm a novice when it comes to computers. I can get around a little bit. But think if somebody was trying to explain to me or to you that maybe don't are the same level of understanding of computers that I am, maybe they were trying to share with you the intricacies of how a computer works, you know, and all the programs and maybe even the hardware and stuff, and they were trying to explain that all that to you. And I just, stop. My mind is hurting, you know? And you come away from that, you're less understand about how a computer works now than you did before the person started talking about it, you know? And so maybe you've had that, maybe in a similar topic, there's something they've tried to explain something to you, and if they've tried to explain it to you, you're like, you walk away and it's like, that just made me more confused, right? So sometimes that happens. So another way Satan attempts to turn us from God is he appeals to our flesh, doesn't he? I'm not talking about our physical flesh. I'm talking about our fleshly desires, our selfish nature. He allures us through the social media, you know, and what's going on there. He allures us through advertisements. We're bombarded with advertisements. You know, you got to have this because if you do, then you'll be happy. You know, wear these clothes, wear this perfume, have this object, purchase this, and you're going to be happy. You're going to be fulfilled. You're going to be satisfied. He allures us through music, you know, through getting wrong thoughts into our mind through music. He allures us through materialism, you know, possessions. But our only safety to combat all these deceptions and allurements of Satan is what? Is the Word of God. The Word of God. John 17:17. Jesus speaking there in John 17, he's speaking to his Father in the upper room. He's praying there in John 17. He says, sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. And we know that word sanctify means to be set apart for a holy purpose. So God's saying, Jesus is saying, set them apart by your truth, Father. Set them apart by your truth. To not be of the world and its mindset. And the way they're going to be set apart from the worldly mindset is by your truth, by your word. Psalm 119:11. Your word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. Here the psalmist says, the way we can keep from sinning against God, from separating ourselves from God, is to put God's word in our mind and live by that word that's in our mind. We know that Jesus used scripture to resist Satan in the wilderness there, didn't he? And in Luke 4:18, Jesus is asked to read in the synagogue. And he's reading, so they give him the scroll, and he reads from Isaiah 61:1, which tells us his purpose in coming to this earth, right? He says, he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. You know, it's interesting because in the King James Version, it says to preach the gospel to the meek. So it not necessarily is talking about the people that are poor in financial means, but poor in spirit, poor in understanding of God. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed. So to preach the gospel to the poor, the good news to those who are poor in spirit, to those that recognize their great emptiness, their great unfulfilledness in life, and they realize they need something more. Jesus says, I came to those people that are looking for something more, that know that they're not fulfilled. I came to give them a message of hope, a message of love. To those that are brokenhearted, Jesus came to bring healing. And there are many, maybe even in this congregation, that are brokenhearted because of situations in their life, because of occurrences in their life, experiences they've had, and they're brokenhearted, and they need to be healed. Jesus said, I can heal you. If you'll come to me, I can heal you. I can mend that broken heart. To proclaim liberty to the captives. And this isn't talking about people that are necessarily in physical prison, but people that are in bondage to their own sin. Maybe it's addictions to drugs or pornography or whatever. They're trapped in something, in sin, and they long to be free, but they don't know how to get out of it. Jesus says, I got strength to give to you so you can be free of it. Come to me. I can make you free from it. Recovery of sight to the blind, right? So those that are blind, they can't see, right? They can't see. So in John chapter 9, verses 39 and 40 through 41, Jesus said, for judgment I have come into this world that those who do not see may see, and that those who see may be made blind. Then some of the Pharisees who were with him heard these words and said to him, are we blind also? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no sin. But now you say, we see. Therefore, your sin remains. So the recovery of sight to the blind are those that recognize that they're in darkness, that they're in error, and that they know that there's got to be some truth out there. There's got to be light out there, because a life shouldn't be like this. But there are those, like in this little passage we read, that think they're doing just fine. They think they're, if you were blind, if you didn't understand, if you didn't know, then you wouldn't be held accountable for the things you don't know. But because you think you do know, you think you are okay in your condition, you really are blind. That's what Jesus is telling them there. They had a misconception about the character of God, and they thought they were just fine. So in other words, in regards to Luke 4:18, what Jesus is saying there is that we are all broken in one form or another. And we all need healing and restoration in some way, of some kind. The question is, do we realize that we need it? Do we realize that we're spiritually blind, or maybe we're brokenhearted, or that we're poor in spirit? Do we realize these things? That's why none of us can boast, because we all are in need of healing. None of us can boast and say, you know, I'm doing just fine. We need to recognize our continual need of healing and restoration. We can only receive from God. We can only receive that from God, the true restoration, the true healing. And it's only Jesus that can make us whole. He is the one, and he's the only one that can change our hearts to be more kind, to be more compassionate, to be more patient. And for those that have tried to be more patient, more compassionate, more kind, because you said, I need to do that, and I need to be more kind, I need to be more patient, and you tried to do it, how is that working for you? How is that working for you, trying to do it on your own? See, when we call upon God, when we cry out to God for our need, we are giving God permission to work in us, to work in our hearts, because we recognize that we can't do it. And because we realize that God is not going to work in us against our will, we need to give him permission. We need to ask him, because God honors free will. He honors free choice. And he's not going to work in us unless we give him permission. And as we learn to cooperate with God by spending time with him and learning to yield ourselves to the influence of the Holy Spirit, He begins to make remarkable changes in our life. Remarkable changes. Changes that we may not perceive are happening. They may be imperceptible to us, but other people around us will notice. They'll notice, hey, he doesn't get irritated like he used to. She doesn't blow up like she used to. You know? They'll realize there's something happening in our lives where we may not even know it, because we see our faultiness, we see how we mess up every now and then, but for some reason, they don't see that. They see a change in us. And as the Lord is making these changes in us, he sends us out as ambassadors to others so that they can know of the wonderful love of God as well. I want to share a little story with you. It's about a man by the name of Jeff Rich. Maybe some of you know him. Jeff Rich has a ministry called Layman Ministries up in Idaho. And Jeff Rich, in his younger days, he was drug addict, addicted to drugs. He was in a rock and roll band. He was into rock and roll, you know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, all that stuff. He was into all that stuff. But he came to know of Jesus. The Lord was able to reach his heart, and he came to know Jesus, and his life was turned around. And he now has a ministry, like I said. Well, I heard this account years ago when I met him back in 1993. So this is actually a relatively, when he was newer in his ministry. But I want to share this story with you to give you a little idea of how God uses us as ambassadors for him when we allow ourselves to maybe be doing things that are outside our comfort zone. And so this story goes like this. It says, his name was Art. Most people in the small Four Corners town knew of him, but no one seemed to know him. The scruffy bearded operator of an auto salvage on the edge of the Navajo reservation, Art mumbled more than talked and used words you would not want to repeat. He always wore a red and black plaid hunting jacket, and had a handgun tucked away under his jacket. I stopped in one time to check on a used truck part. Art was short with me and would not allow me to go inside the fenced area where all the salvaged vehicles were sitting. I left empty-handed. The holidays were upon us, and it was getting cold at night. The Southwest desert can be that way in the winter. Daytimes, it can be in the low 70s, and nighttimes, down into the teens. On Christmas Eve, I was thinking about Art. He lived alone by the salvage yard in a small travel trailer. I was never sure how he bathed, or if he bathed. I asked my wife, Christy, and my two little girls to make some cookies and to go buy some oranges and apples. We then, as a family, put together a fruit cookie basket for Art. Christmas morning, there was a hard frost on the ground. My family made our way to Art's small travel trailer. We went to the door, knock, knock, knock. We heard a voice, rough voice yell, "Who's there?" "Hey, Art, this is Jeff and family." The door slowly opened, and there was Art in his red and black plaid jacket and that gun, which was visible as he leaned into the door's opening. "What do you want?" he mumbled. "Here, Art, this is Christmas morning, and we know a lot of people are spending this holiday time with family and friends. We were just thinking about you, and that you are most likely all by yourself. So we put together this Christmas basket for you and want to wish you a Merry Christmas." Art stood there, speechless. As we handed him the basket, I noticed a small tear coming down his cheek as he softly said, "Thank you." A few weeks later, my truck broke down in the desert, and I needed a receiver to pull a trailer to go fetch it. I stopped in and asked Art if he had a receiver with a 2-inch ball. He looked at me, handed me the keys to the shop. "I think there's one in the pile of parts to the left, just inside the door of my shop." A week later, I was in a small store, and the lady who was at the till was chatting with me. She brought up Art. She looked at me with a bit of curiosity. "Art was in here the other day, Jeff. I do not know what you did, but for some reason, Art likes you. And believe me, he doesn't like many people." That Christmas morning, a seemingly hard heart was touched by something as simple as a few cookies and some fruit. I am convinced there are a lot of people like Art. Maybe not in every way, but many are lonely and come across as unlovable. We all can be faithful with the talents God has given us. An act of kindness, words of encouragement, and a helping hand are talents we all can possess. Jeff and his family were willing to go outside their comfort zone. And what a difference it made in that man's life. You know, where he is in his walk with the Lord, I don't know. But his heart was softened, at least at that moment, at least toward Jeff. The Lord knows the rest of the story. Maybe we'll find out when we get on the other side. But in 1 Corinthians 13, 1-3, it says this. "Though," and many of you know these verses, I'm sure, "though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I have become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing." See, we can have all these things, can't we? We can have the understanding of all the mysteries. We can have the greatest faith in the world. We can speak like angels speak. We can be willing to even give of ourselves sacrificially, completely, even to the giving up of our bodies. We may have all these things, know all knowledge, but if we don't have love, what good is it? What good is it having all this in your head, all this that you know about, if love is not the catalyst behind all of it? In John 13, 34 and 35, which was read for our scripture verse, "A new commandment," Jesus says, "I give to you, that you love one another, as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another." Now, was this really a new commandment to the disciples? Well, in a sense it was, but in a sense it wasn't. Because in the book of Deuteronomy, they were told to love your neighbor as yourself. It's the book of Leviticus. It may have been in Deuteronomy as well, but I remember the verses in Leviticus. But they were told to love your neighbor as yourself. So they knew about loving one another. So how was it a new commandment to the disciples and the people of Israel? Jesus had given them a new demonstration of what love really is. Their idea of love was clouded. They did not understand what love really is from the extent that God wanted them to understand. Now Jesus had given them a true example of what love is, and now was giving them the commission to bid them to go out and repeat that kind of love in their lives. He had given them a new concept of what love is, of what the love of God is all about, a new picture of who God is, what he's like. So you can profess to have great faith. You can profess to follow the health message as is given an inspiration to the letter. You can be able to give an indisputable presentation on the legitimacy and the authority of the Sabbath as the true day of worship. You may present the prophecies of Daniel and Revelation flawlessly and with great accuracy. But, yes, there is a but if having this experience, if having all this knowledge does not make you kind, sincere, patient, forbearing, loving, compassionate, your experience is a curse to yourself. It's a curse to you. Why? Because possessing the truth and living the truth are two different things. Remember, I'm telling this sermon for me as much as I am for you. I said that in the beginning. If we just possess the truth, we are self-deceived into believing we are all right, when actually we are all wrong. That's why Jesus said in Matthew 21:31, the tax collectors and the harlots go into heaven before you do. And he was speaking to the religious leaders, the ones that knew the truth. Why? Because they did not recognize their need. The harlots and tax collectors, they did recognize their need. They did recognize their need. They recognized their sinfulness. They recognized their only hope was in Jesus. But the religious leaders, they did not recognize their need. They were satisfied with their knowledge of God. Because, hey, you know what? We're experts in Scripture. We're the one people need to come to if they want to know what Scripture's all about. Surely, we're going to heaven because of our knowledge of Scripture. See, we may say, well, I know I'm a sinner, and I know I'm saved by grace. I'm not like those Pharisees. I'm not like those religious leaders. But let me ask you, after 5, 10, 20, 40, 60 years in this church, have we settled into the idea that I'm safe because I'm in the right church with the right teaching? I'm okay because I'm unmoved on the Sabbath. I'm solid there. You're not going to get me away from the Sabbath. I know the state of the dead. In fact, I can give a Bible study on the state of the dead. I'm not going to fall for that secret rapture belief that's going out there. You know, there's too many holes in that teaching. I know the truth about how Jesus is coming in the clouds. But the question we need to ask ourselves is, are we possessing the truth or are we living the truth? And as I said before, merely possessing the truth, it becomes a curse to us. And the experience of merely possessing the truth, we become not only a curse to ourselves, we become a curse to the world by merely possessing the truth. Why? Because now we've given a false representation of what Jesus is like to the world. We've said, this is what Jesus is like. But we don't represent him in character. See, Jesus is not looking merely for people who know the Word of God, but through those who emulate his character in their lives. And that can only be accomplished one way, There's no alternative methods. There's no secondary backup. And my Bible study students know that I'm a broken record because week after week I would share this with my Bible study students, for those of you that are my Bible students out there. And what is the only way that this character of Jesus can be reproduced in our life? The Holy Spirit, right? The Holy Spirit. We can't make it happen. 2 Corinthians 3:18, but we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror, looking as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord, we're being transformed into the same image from glory to glory. How? Just as by the Spirit of the Lord. It's only by the Spirit of the Lord that we can be changed into the likeness of Jesus. And the Holy Spirit's more than willing to do this in our life. All he's asking for us is to come to him and to learn of him. And guess what? We can even pray and ask the Lord to put that desire in our heart to want to spend time with the Lord if we don't have it. Because he wants time with us. He wants to spend time with us. He is willing to change our characters so that we can have a character like his. But again, like I said, he's not going to do it against our will. But if we ask him, he will change us into his likeness. See, the world and its attractions are pulling on us every day to fulfill our own desires. The world's, you feel that pulling? You feel the world trying to get its hands on you to get you to fall into line with the desires of the world? And our own sinful nature is enticing us to follow our own inclination in how we respond when we feel we've been wronged, to follow our own inclination when someone has been unkind to us, to follow our own inclination when someone around us is irritating us or annoying us. But it's only by God's grace and our submission to the working of the Holy Spirit in our life that our life will emulate the life of Christ. You notice James says in James 4:7 there, he says that submit to God and resist the devil. You notice the submission part has to come first. And for us, that's not easy, is it, to submit, to surrender? Because in the world, surrender means to lose. But in God's way of looking at things, submission means to have victory. So my prayer for each one of us, including myself, is may we allow Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, to transform us by his grace, that we may rightly represent him to the world, is my prayer. Amen. Now, our closing song. I'm not sure what it is here.
Becky, our lead chorister, had to go home to take care of an emergency. So we're down to two, and I'm used to singing harmony, so I hope you can sing the melody. Will that work? So if you want to stand, we're going to sing in a little while, We're Going Home.
Everlasting.
Father, that sounds so good, to be going home in a little while. Where we look at the world, we see all the pain and heartache there is in the world. We see the damage that's being done in the lives of your people, Lord. And Lord, we think that whether young or old, Lord, we don't want to see that continue. That we want to be in a place where there is joy and peace. There's no more pain, no more sorrow, no more sickness, no more death. Lord, finish in us the work that you've begun, that we might represent you to a lost and dying world, to a world in darkness, that as you finish your work in us, Lord, that it will illuminate this world to see that there is something, there is hope beyond the existence that people are dealing with right now, and that they will turn to you and know the joy of your salvation. Is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.